Welcome to Your Voice, a program for you to see how Senator John DeFrancisco is representing you in the New York State Senate. I'm Julia Locandy. Hi, Senator. How are you today?
I'm doing very well. Thank you.
I saw that you were inducted into the Liverpool Fine Arts.
Yeah, the Wall of Fame, I think they call it, which is a real honor that it was special because one of the other people that was inducted was a young fellow who was at Liverpool High School maybe 6 or 7 years ago, and he was a great musician, a drummer, and he went on and did great things. He's now teaching at Ithaca College, teaching music, and now he's a mentor for young musicians. And I remember I would go to see him all the time and a group of young high school kids that used to play at a coffee shop right near my law office. And he was an excellent musician and a little wild, on edge at that time. Now he's an accomplished young man who his speech was magnificent, thanking the right people and having the right attitude. It was good. So it was a real honor, and it had all the people that helped that music program out there over the years, and it's excellent. It's absolutely excellent.
Right. So you are, another thing, you're asking your constituents to let you know which teachers are really making a difference out there.
You know, when you go to an event like that, the Hall of Fame or Wall of Fame for Liverpool, and you see all these teachers that have had such an influence on some of these young people's lives, and the young people thanking them for it. And nowadays, the teaching profession is always under a microscope with the Common Core, with the teacher evaluations, and, you know, I know it's extremely difficult to be a teacher in this day and age, plus kids that don't pay attention or are disciplinary problems, and there's assaults in the schools. You know, I think it's time to turn that around and start recognizing teachers who are doing great things with students rather than only hearing the negatives about what students are doing or not doing in the schools. So we have a Teachers of Excellence program for our Senate district. And what we're going to do is recognize teachers who have excelled in such a way that their peers are recommending them for an award. And the applications or the nominations can come to my office at 333 East Washington Street in Syracuse or online. The online is the best way to do it, defrancisco.newyorksenate.gov. And we'll review the applications, and we're going to choose those who have excelled and honor them. And the application deadline is May 16th.
Right.
So you still have time. Recognize some good teachers, and maybe we can recognize them as well.
Yeah, good teachers worth so much, so no doubt they should be recognized.
Absolutely, absolutely.
You want to create a commission on prosecutorial misconduct. Is there anything like this right now?
I don't think any state has this right now. And what we've heard many, many times over the last few years of convictions that have been overturned where people have been in jail for many, many years, or people claiming that prosecutors did this illegally or that illegally. Now, there's two parts of that. The two parts are it may be a legitimate allegation and maybe something totally spurious that someone just is knocking the fact that he got caught and got prosecuted. But there's no real forum to determine the truth of these allegations or determine whether the prosecution did anything wrong or not. Prosecutors have more discretion than any public official, in my judgment. Not only do they have discretion as to who to prosecute, how to prosecute, and where that prosecution ultimately ends up. And with that broad discretion, I believe, comes a substantially greater amount of accountability. And right now, we learn of prosecutorial misconduct after several years after someone has gone to jail, and they later are released, and the state pays a lot of money, and there's really no accountability to that prosecutor. It may very well be that it happened years before, and after a lengthy jail sentence, that prosecutor is long gone. He may be someplace else. So, lastly, with respect to the problem, just a couple of weeks ago in the Bronx, a judge just blew up at a prosecutor for withholding evidence on a rape case causing someone to be held in jail on a rape case. And when the judge learned of it, he banned this assistant district attorney from his courtroom. Big deal. That doesn't remedy the situation. That doesn't hold him accountable because the individual is still going to be prosecuting someone in another court before a different judge. So for years, we've had the Judicial Commission on Judicial Conduct, and it's a place where people can file a complaint, where disinterested individuals can review the allegations and then either say there's nothing to it or discipline the judge for that type of activity. Now, it seemed to me, as I was thinking of this process, why shouldn't there be a similar vehicle with respect to allegations against prosecutors? And that's the whole purpose of the bill. And I've introduced it, and Assemblyman Perry has introduced it in the Assembly. And we're going to try to get that bill passed. And it'll not only clear the name of prosecutors who are things are being said about them that is not true, but it'll also provide some type of remedy for those against those prosecutors that are not acting ethically.
How would the members of the commission, would they be voted on or appointed?
It would be appointed. There'd be 11. The governor has two. Each of the, according to the bill now, it could change. The majority party in the Senate and the Assembly each have two. The minority parties each have one. And the court system, the chief judge, has three. It adds up to 11. And, you know, I saw some complaints about, well, you know, it's going to be the same old politician. How else do you pick them? What, are you going to have a general election each year to put people on these commissions? And you got to have some system, and this is fair from from the Assembly, the Senate, the governor, the courts, everybody that has a stake in government in this system is going to be able to appoint somebody. And there's rules against, it can't be all prosecutors. There has to be a mix of individuals so that it's a fair system.
Right, and that's why you elect people that you can trust.
That is true. Mm-hmm. That is true.
You sponsor a bill that would protect crime victims by restricting violent felons from accessing the records of people they committed a crime against.
Correct, and you would think, how could this possibly happen? Yeah. Well, it has happened, and someone might misuse a subpoena, someone might just go in and make I'm the father of this child, and the child was a victim. I have a right to those records of the child. I'm the father. Well, what this bill says that you cannot do that unless you have a court order, a court-ordered subpoena or a court order on records, so that the victims are protected. And a lot, you know, for example, the school system, you know, most people don't really know what the law is. And if the father comes in, you think that father is entitled to it. So that's the purpose of it. It's further protection of victims of violent criminal activity.
So what is the status of this legislation right now?
It's in committee. I expect it to pass the Senate. Whether it'll pass the Assembly or not, I have no idea. Sometimes these tough-on-crime bills languish in the Assembly and they don't get passed, and hopefully this one will be an exception.
So what exactly would it do?
With respect to violent felons, you cannot simply go somewhere and get the records. Even if you hand them a subpoena, then the subpoena could be falsified. Mm-hmm. You have to have a specific court order to get records. Now, why would someone legitimately have that right to records? It may very well be that they're accused of another crime, and that person would take the witness stand. And there may be something relevant in records that defendant can use in cross-examination. But there has to be safeguards, so it's just not trying to get all records about anything about that person, because that's not a legitimate reason to have those records. Mm-hmm. So it gives the court the opportunity to review the request, the reasons for the request, and maybe limit the records that are available, rather than simply serving a subpoena through an attorney that individual obtains.
Is there an Assembly sponsor?
Yes, there is.
There is.
And it may go. I just don't know. It's difficult to say. There's so many bills to keep track of each one. Yeah. In the Assembly. I'm just trying to get it through the Senate, And then if it does, then I'll work on making the assembly member try to take it more seriously.
Right. So more information on your website, defrancisco.mysenate.gov. We talk about legislation a lot on this program. What else are you involved in back in the district?
You know, it's people have little idea what individuals in public office do. And it's not only the legislation, it's not only constituent service. Every day someone calls with a major problem. It could be the bureaucracy of government they can't get through. It could be, like this last week, someone came in to see me in my district who was bilked by a contractor. They started doing work and made more and more damage and then asked for more and more money. It was clearly a fraudulent operation. He found out that others others were also defrauded by this same contractor. He went to the Attorney General's office. He said they've done nothing. So I'm looking now into that complaint to see, and he's more concerned about protecting other people now. He knows he's in a bind himself, and he'd have to sue to try to go after money if that person had any, which is often not the case. You know, what laws are there now, and what things can be done? Should we require bonding of all contractors? Should we require licensing of all contractors? So there's a process to try to screen some of these people out at the outset, and we're doing research on it. So constituent service. I have office hours the day after I get back from Albany. Actually, sometimes the afternoon I get back from Albany. We have every half hour there's constituents coming in on various issues, and we try to deal with them. In addition, the nighttime and the weekends are always consumed with something. This last weekend, for example, I went to two Little League opening days, and it's fun. I relive my youth and always try to give them a little information about how baseball helped me and how being a member of a team will help you. And in fact, I mentioned this weekend that on May 22nd, a coach that used to coach us in our summer league teams when I was a little kid turned 80. And I've arranged for a reunion for players that played over a 10-year period under this coach. And we got a great result. It's a Father Joseph Conti, his name is. He married my wife and I many, many years ago, I think, almost 46. He married a bunch of the baseball players, too. And one of the interesting things, I don't think any of them got divorced. And it's an unusual thing at this day and age. Mm-hmm. So he's got a magic sign of the cross, I think. But he was a wonderful man. He is a wonderful man. And we got a bunch of people and their spouses or significant others to come, and we're going to have a great time. On Saturday night, I went to a dinner for the Baldwinsville Volunteer Center. And each year they honor the male and female volunteers of the year. And these individuals were unbelievable, the things they've done in the community over the years. And some of the previous winners were there. And it was a very, very nice event. Now, I enjoy doing that because you get to know more about your district. You get to know more people who have done great things. And for example, we just mentioned the Commission on Judicial or Prosecutorial Misconduct. If that bill passes, the Senate's got to name a couple people. It may be in my travels that I find individuals, and I have in the past, recommended appointment to various commissions and boards and so forth. You see who in the community is out there that would do a wonderful job. So it was a lot of fun, but it's also very taxing because at the same time I'm in Baldwinsville, a staff member was at fire department annual dinner because there's three or four events every night. And so it's tough to get to all of them, but I try to get to as many as I can.
And we like to show them on this program. Thanks so much for being with us, Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on what we discussed, defrancisco.mysenate.gov.